So let's define what a colligative property is. And there are multiple colligative properties. So in this lesson, we're going to define colligative properties, and we're going to focus in on the first one, which utilizes something called Raoult's law. Okay, so what is a colligative property? It's a property that depends upon the number of solute particles in the solution. And it is not on the nature of the solute particles. So it doesn't depend on whether it's molecular or ionic. It only depends upon how many particles are dissolved in it. And so that's what a colligative property is. Now, if you're going to talk about the number of solute particles, you're going to have to take into account that Van't Hoff factor. So we will be considering the I in order to determine the number of particles in solution. Okay? So there's going to be four that we are going to focus on. And to me, it's important that you learn the names because they help us understand the direction of how these colligative properties go. Okay, the first one is vapor pressure lowering. When you hear that word lowering, what it's saying is as you add more and more particles, the vapor pressure is going to go down. It's vapor pressure lowering. The second one is boiling point elevation. As you add more and more particles, the boiling point will go up. Okay, the third one is freezing point depression. As you add more and more solute particles, the freezing point will go down. And what you may or may not be aware of at this point in your life is that boiling point and freezing point and melting point are the same place, okay? So it's a temperature which is going to melt or freeze is going to be depressed. It's going to go down. The next one, I don't know why, but it's never got the qualifier, okay? It just says osmotic pressure. But it is an osmotic pressure elevation, so you could put that in there if you wanted to. The osmotic pressure will go up as you have more and more solute particles. So if I were queen of the world, I would call it osmotic pressure elevation, okay? Or some other thing that tells me that the pressure is going to go up as you put more and more particles in there. So we're going to focus on the first one, which is vapor pressure lowering. But before we do, I do have this little qualifier. Each of these are going to be nice linear relationships that we're going to learn, okay? Really direct proportionalities. As one goes up, the other one goes up, or indirect proportionalities. As one goes up, the other one goes down in a direct fashion. And so we're going to see this linearity happening. But this linearity only happens when we keep the concentrations low. Once you bring the concentrations higher, the nice linear relationships that we're learning are going to fall apart. Now, with that qualifier, if you run across a solution that's greater than 0.2 molar, don't just throw up your hands and say, I can't do this one. Just assume it's behaving in this ideal fashion, even though in reality it's not. You might run across some problems where the author of the question wasn't being really careful of keeping it under that concentration and wants you to work the problem anyway. But you should be aware that you have to keep the concentration fairly low to see these nice linear relationships. Okay, so it says over there on the left-hand side of the screen, vapor pressure lowering. So that's the one that we're going to look at. We're going to look at two cases. We're going to look at case one and where the solute is non-volatile. Now, a lot of times people think volatility means it's going to explode or not explode. That is not what it means in the chemistry world. To be non-volatile, it means it is not going to evaporate. It has no measurable vapor pressure. So if I took sodium chloride and sprinkled it out here, came back a month later and nobody's cleaned it up, it's all just sitting there. It hasn't evaporated away. It is a non-volatile solute, okay? So that's the first case that we're going to look at where the solute itself won't have any vapor pressure, okay? And here is the relationship. The vapor pressure of a non-volatile solution is always less than its vapor pressure lowering than that of the pure solvent. So if pure solvent's going to evaporate away, the non-volatile solute that you add will bring the vapor pressure down. And Raoult's law is the mathematical relationship of this. This equation on the left-hand side is the vapor pressure of the solvent above the solution. And on the right-hand side, with that little circle you see there, that's the vapor pressure of pure solvent. And you see that that X, that chi, that is that mole fraction that we learned about when we were talking about concentration units, okay? So let's look at it and label each thing. Notice that both the P has a 1 with it and the X has a 1 with it. We're talking about the same substance. So we're talking about the mole fraction of the solvent, okay? That's kind of a weird thing, okay? The X sub 1, that is the vapor pressure of the, or the mole fraction of the solvent, not the solute. So we're going to have the, let me see how we have it. Oh, let's go ahead and label the rest of it, and then I'll go back and talk about that X, about the mole fraction. The vapor pressure is the pressure without the circle is the vapor pressure above the solution, and with the circle is the vapor pressure of the pure solvent. You're generally given the vapor pressure of the pure solvent at that temperature, and you're being asked to calculate the vapor pressure of a solution, okay? So you're usually calculating the vapor pressure of the solution, though you might be calculating the mole fraction. Let's just talk really briefly about that mole fraction that I have labeled this way. That's the mole fraction of the solvent, which means this. It's the moles of the solvent. Weird, okay, because when we talk about concentration units, we're usually talking about the concentration of the solute, how much of it is dissolved, but it's the moles of the solvent over total moles of everything in there. That would be the solvent and the each solute particle, okay? This is another way of expressing Raoult's law. How does the vapor pressure change? When we do it this way, we can talk about X2, which is the vapor pressure of the solute instead, okay? So this equation would be using the mole fraction of the solute. So X2, the way I've described it, would be the moles of the solute, which is a more normal way of thinking of a concentration unit, over total moles, that is moles of solvent and all the solute particles. Both of these are the same equation, just looking at it a little bit differently. They are interchangeable. I have never found a case where it is easier to use the bottom one than the top one, though you might have a question which says, how much was the vapor pressure lowered? And they want to know the delta P. How much did it change by? But you could still use the top equation, and then once you solve for P1, just subtract it from the pure solvent, and you've got how much it changed by. So while both of them are true, you don't have to memorize them both. You can probably just hang on to one or the other. And for me, I tend to hang on to the top one and use it for every one of my problems. But I just have to remember very carefully that we're talking about moles of solvent on the top when we're dealing with that top one and its concentration unit. Okay? Now, I don't use an ion here because when I'm talking about moles, total moles, I'm talking about moles of the solvent, that's the thing doing the dissolving, plus moles of the solute. And if it's an ionic compound, let's say it was sodium chloride, I would have in the denominator moles of sodium ions plus moles of chloride ions. So I don't generally talk about the Van't Hoff factor because I can go for this mole fraction and determine the moles of everything that's in there and dissolve it by two, I mean multiply it by two. You might see cases where they worked the Van't Hoff factor in there instead of thinking of it this way, but that's how I choose to think about it. So that's case one. Now, Raoult's law says that the vapor pressure is going to lower when you put it in solution. So what's happening on the molecular level that causes that? Well, let's go over to the screen here and let's see what's happening. On the left is the pure water, okay? Who gets to evaporate? Well, it's only surface molecules of water that can evaporate and go up into the gas phase. And it's being captured by the surface and going back down to the surface. But when we add a solute, some of those surface molecules are being occupied by solute. So in a sense, we have decreased the surface area of solvent molecules. There's fewer solvent molecules on the surface. So you're going to get less of them to be able to evaporate up. The rate of evaporation, well, I'll call it vaporization, okay, is lower in this case. And if the rate of vaporization is lower, you're going to have a lower pressure of that vapor above the solution. So that's what's happening on the molecular level that causes the vapor pressure to lower. And more solute you add, the lower and lower the vapor pressure is going to be. So let's work a problem here, okay? We've got a problem here where we're given the vapor pressure of pure water. Let's give myself a little line here. We've got a vapor pressure of pure water of 17.5 millimeters of mercury. So if I write Raoult's law, the vapor pressure of water is equal to the mole fraction of the water, notice that I'm writing the solvent here, times the vapor pressure of pure water. What they have given me so far is the vapor pressure of the pure water. They have given me its vapor pressure is 17.5 millimeters of mercury. Did they give me the mole fraction of just water? No, they told me how many grams of glucose is being dissolved into a certain number of grams of water. So they're giving me the ability to calculate a mole fraction, and then they're asking me what is the vapor pressure of the water above the solution. So I've got to obtain this mole fraction. So let's go off and let's obtain that mole fraction. The mole fraction is equal of for water would be the moles of water over the moles of water, and since this is a non-electrolyte, it doesn't break apart, so we would get the moles of sucrose. So we look and say, well, they didn't give me those either. So let's get the moles of water, and we'll come over here and put them in just a moment. I have, for the water, 350 grams. Okay, so I'm going to go from grams of water to moles of water. Every mole of water is 18.015 grams of water. And that would give me a moles of water equal to 19.42. Okay, we have a lot of moles of water. And then we take the sucrose. We have 200 grams of sucrose. And I'm just going to call it SUC for sucrose, okay? And I don't want grams. I want moles. So I need the molar mass of sucrose with its 12 carbons, 22 hydrogens, and 11 oxygens, and it has a molar mass of 342. Oh, let's see, point, I got some other numbers there, 3, 4. Okay, so I went and determined the molar mass of all that sucrose, and that would give me the moles of sucrose. Now, that is going to be a value of 0.5842. I'm dividing by a pretty big number here, so I have less than a mole. I have point, I said it already, but now I've lost it. Pardon me, 0.5842. And this is of the sucrose, and this is of the water. So now I can come up here and get a mole fraction. The mole fraction is the moles of water, 19.42 moles, divided by total moles, which is 19.42, plus the 0.5842. Mole fractions are a unitless value because the moles are canceling, and we're left with a mole fraction of 9708. Okay, that is the mole fraction. Why did I want a mole fraction? Because I wanted the pressure, and I needed to use Raoult's law for that. So I can put the 0.9708 here. This is always, it's a fraction, so it's got to be a number less than 1, or you've done something wrong. It's more water than anything else, so it's going to change the vapor pressure ever so slightly, and it's going to bring that vapor pressure down to 17.0 millimeters of mercury. And when you get your answer, you should check your thinking. It is called vapor pressure what? Lowering. Did it lower the vapor pressure? Yes, indeed it did. So that is how you work a problem using Raoult's law. Now, just a word of caution that I see students run into. We learn something called Henry's law. And then we have Raoult's law. Students get really confused of which one they need to use. You need to realize that this is dealing with the concentration of a gas with a pressure of that gas above solution. This is a pressure of the solvent, both in or the solution, and the mole fraction of that solvent. So different situations. This is a pressure of a gas and pushing it into solution. This is the vapor pressure of the solvent. So make sure you pull out the right one for the right scenario. Okay, let's look at the next one. This is case two. In case two, both the solute and the solvent are going to evaporate. We call them volatile, okay? That means they will evaporate. They will have a measurable vapor pressure. So the solvent will produce some pressure above the solution, and the solute will also do so. So Raoult's law works equally well. You can still use this equation right here when you're dealing with the case two situation. But the only difference is you're going to have to do it twice. You're going to do it for one of the substances that you're calling the solvent, okay? Because it's going to evaporate and give you a vapor pressure. And then you're going to do it for the solute because it will also evaporate. So you will use this equation for the solute. And then you will just do it for both and add them together, and that would give you the total pressure above the solution. Okay? So just to kind of walk through a situation, toluene and benzene are both liquids. They both will evaporate, and we could make a solution of a mixture of these two. They are both nonpolar. They only have dispersion force. They make a very nice miscible solution to any ratio of solvent and solute. So we could use this equation for the toluene. We would use the mole fraction of toluene, which would mean the moles of toluene over total moles, moles of toluene, moles of benzene. We would put that there times its vapor pressure of pure toluene. Then we would do it for the benzene. We would take and say, okay, what's the mole fraction of benzene in here? Moles of benzene over total moles times the vapor pressure of pure benzene. We would get those two values, and then we can simply add them together. So this is only true for ideal solutions. And let me just, a word of ideal solutions. Ideal solutions are when the solvent and the solute, when they dissolve in each other, they have very, very similar intermolecular forces. Both of these are nonpolar. They both only have dispersion. They're very similar in molar masses, and they make an ideal solution. But there are deviations from ideality where what you get when you add these is not exactly what you would get in reality. It might be a little greater, and we call those positive deviations from ideal. Or it might be negative, a little lower, and we call those negative deviations. But for you in this class, assume ideality, and if you're called to determine the pressure above a solution where both the solvent and the solute are evaporating, then you'll just do Raoult's law twice and add those numbers together. All right, so that is the first colligative property, vapor pressure lowering. We use Raoult's law to calculate how it changes, and we have three more to consider after this one.